So that's what I talked about before. Now let's keep reading this table to see what all this other numbers is going on about. So first, let's jump down to the footnotes. Okay, there's a lot of footnotes here. So we see notes. Standard error is shown in parentheses. Okay, so that is good. That lets us know that this is a standard error, and we can see whether our causal difference in difference estimate is statistically significant or not. And that's usually the case. Parentheses usually mean standard errors. But they just double reinforce that that's the case. Okay, next they say, the sample consists of all stores with available data on employment. Okay, so in all of these numbers, they've got data on different fast food stores, and if they had some data from that store, they include it in their sample. FTE means full-time equivalent employment. Okay, so now we know what FTE means, full-time equivalent, and they're defining here what that means. It counts each part-time worker as half a full-time worker. So what they're saying is, well, we know that not everyone who works at fast food stores works full-time. Some people work part-time. So how do we count them? Well, just half. So 0.5 of a worker is somebody who works part-time. So that's why we have 0.33, 0.17. That lets us interpret what it means to have fractional workers. Then let's keep going. Employment at 6 closed stores is set to 0. So some stores were closed in some time periods. They're just going to set employment to 0. Employment at 4 temporarily closed stores is treated as missing, which means we don't even include them in our averages. So, data's not perfect. So they're going to have to deal with that somehow. They're just explaining what they're doing when they don't see some data for some stores. They're going to treat it as missing for these 4 temporarily closed stores. And when the 6 stores were closed, they set it equal to 0. Okay. So that's just this first block that we've talked about before. Well, let's keep reading down this way. Let's look at row 4. Change in mean FTE, full-time equivalent employment, balanced sample stores. What does that mean? Oh, there's a footnote. See footnote C. Subset of stores with available employment data in wave 1 and wave 2. So that means that they're now only going to include stores where they saw data for that store both before and after the policy change. Whereas earlier, we were including, say, stores in Pennsylvania before the policy change in this average, even if we didn't have data on that particular store after the policy change. Okay, so now we're going to drop some, we're going to use this little bit of subset of our data where we only observe for those stores where we see the data for both time periods. And if we just use that subset of data, we again find basically the same causal effect. So this is a robustness check. It's seeing whether this number is robust in some sense. If we change exactly which stores we keep in the data set, or we change our definitions a little bit, then does the number hold up? So this first robustness is, yes, it does. Okay, now let's go to the next line, 5. Change in mean FTE employment, setting FTE at temporarily closed stores to 0. Okay. So here, in the earlier footnote, it said employment at 4 temporarily closed stores is treated as missing. That means we're not even including the stores in our average. So now, we're going to do something a little bit different to treat this data. We're not going to treat it as missing. We're going to include it in our average and set employment to 0. So if we do that, then we find our difference in difference estimate changes a little bit, down to 2.51, but the same over... it's pretty similar to the previous two numbers. So our qualitative conclusion doesn't change. So this is another robustness check that shows that our main estimate holds up. Okay, so that's what all these second two lines are. Now what's going on over here? Well, let's start reading. Stores in New Jersey, and it's a little A here. Okay, well, what's going on? Let's read what they say. Stores in New Jersey were classified by whether starting wage in wave 1, okay, wave 1 is before the policy was changed, which they don't explain, but if you go to the body text, you could figure it out, or you could just think, typically wave 1 is the beginning of any survey or any panel data. You do wave 1, then wave 2, wave 3, etc. Okay, so starting wage in wave 1 equals $4.25 an hour. Okay, that's 101 stores. That or it's between $4.26 and $4.99 per hour. That's 140 stores, or whether it's $5 an hour or higher. That's 73 stores. So they take all the fast food stores they see in the data in New Jersey, look at what they were paying their employees before the minimum wage was increased. Okay, we split them into two groups. Low wage stores, this is where most of their employees were getting paid the minimum wage. Mid-range stores, where you know their employees weren't getting, they were getting paid more than the minimum wage, but not much more. And then high-wage stores, stores where they were getting paid $5 or more on average. Okay, so these are stores where even though the minimum wage is $4.25 before the policy change, these stores are paying their workers $5 or more. Okay, so that's what is going on here. We've categorized the stores in New Jersey. And then for just the stores paying the minimum wage before, we can look at their full-time employment before, is about 19.5 people, and then it increased to about 21 people after the policy change. Same thing, we can do the same analysis for the mid-range stores and the high-wage stores. Okay, so what this is lets us do is we can think about the effect of the minimum wage on just the low-wage stores right here. So we can compare the difference in employment for the low-wage stores to what happened in the common trend in Pennsylvania. And we see that even in low-wage stores, employment went up a little bit. It went up by 1.32. So again, our same difference analysis suggests that the minimum wage is not lowering employment, okay? So, and that's the same conclusion here for the high, for the mid-range stores. Mid-range stores, employment went up just a little bit. Okay, now for the high-wage stores, employment actually went down from before to after, so by about two people, okay? But the overall trend was also downwards by about two people. So the difference estimate for the high-wage stores is about zero, okay? Minus two, minus two. That's about zero. So this shows that over here we were grouping all the stores together and just getting one difference estimate for all the stores. It's showing that where that estimate is coming from is mainly effects of the increase in employment at the low-range stores and the mid-range stores. And the high-wage stores, they pretty much didn't change their wage at all. Okay, and then you can do the same robustness checks for these, that's in some sense a robustness check for your robustness check, by changing the exactly which stores in your sample you got, or by treating missing data slightly differently. And you get sort of similar-ish conclusions for that. If you compare this difference to what was happening in Pennsylvania, or this to what was happening in Pennsylvania, okay,